The man who produces while others dispose of his product is a slave. If I only had 13 words to express why I'm in favor of strong intellectual property laws, the laws that allow creators to control the use of what they have created, I just simply leave you with these 13 words from Ayn Rand. And when I say intellectual property, I mean every area of law that is comprised under that umbrella term, so in copyright, trademarks, and patents. Ayn Rand wrote those 13 words in 1963 in her work, Man's Rights. Honestly, I couldn't say it any better. The man who produces while others dispose of his product is a slave. Indeed, if someone other than the writer has a right to decide whether or not a university professor can make free copies of the writer's book and distribute these copies to the students, that writer is a slave. This has nothing to do with students, has nothing to do with education. It's a matter of principle. And if someone other than the writer has a right to decide whether or not the writer's property can be taken away from him, then the writer has no property. Because the same principle can be used to take that property away from the writer in any other case, when somebody else feels like it. When what you create can be taken away from you, without your consent, you're a slave. And without property rights, your right to life is fiction. If you see nothing wrong with a judge deciding that it's okay for you to download counterfeit copies of software simply because you're not uploading it further, you've just agreed to enslave a company that spent millions of dollars and years to develop that code, to write the code. And this has nothing to do with whether software should be free and open source. This has everything to do with usurpation of the right to decide what software should cost by those who did not create it. A football team, Washington Redskins, had been building its brand awareness for its logo, 45 years. Then comes Comrade Obama, influenced by political correctness mafia and left-wing media mob, and says that if it was up to him, he'd think of changing the name. And conveniently, US Trademarks Office cancels their Redskins trademark registration. How's that for property rights? That's Soviet Union by the book. And I'll tell you more about Soviet Union in a little while. But I think that if you think that this debate is limited to intellectual property, you're not really seeing the big picture. So if a bunch of politicians can order that a subset of patent owners should lose their property for no reason other than they have the audacity to try to enforce it against infringers, don't be mistaken. It's not about protecting legitimate businesses from what they call patent trolls. This is about enslaving inventors and those who invest in their inventions. Elon Musk may gift his patents to the masses all he wants. These were his patents to begin with. And if he feels that giving them away is the best way to attain his goals and attain the goals of his company, this is great. But the crucial point here is that it was his decision. It was his decision he made. And one man's charity does not justify the robbery of everyone else. So trust me, I love free stuff as much as the next guy. But I despise forced redistribution of wealth and property. And I know a little bit about forced redistribution of wealth. You may hear it in my accent when I talk. I come from the capital of forced redistribution of wealth. My people invented it. And to put things into perspective, and to give you some context, since I have some time with you today, and thank you to Karen, where's Karen? Thank you to Karen and Constitutional Foundation for having me here, for inviting me over. I thought it might fascinate you a little bit to hear a story of a guy who was born in Russia, who argued a case one level down from the Supreme Court of Russia when he was still a law student. A story of a PhD in law and a top five intellectual property lawyer in Russia who was months away from becoming the partner with Baker McKenzie, the biggest international law firm in the world, when he suddenly decided to move to North America. Why does a guy like that leave? I'll tell you why. He's being exposed to the Western way of life, I caught the virus, the freedom virus. And I'd like to share with you what it was like to make the journey across the continent, across the ocean, across a language, across the law degree and into a new law degree. You may be curious to know why it is that I was willing to give up being a hotshot lawyer in Russia to start off as a nobody in Canada. And I'm certainly hoping that if you hear this story, it will deepen even your love for the country that most of you were lucky to be born into. Would it be okay if I spend a couple of moments to share my story? Thank you. So I became an intellectual property lawyer 20 years ago when my father, a famous Russian composer, caught a radio station stealing his music and using it in the commercial for Samsung without his permission. I was then attending my second year of law school, and there's 5 years in Russia. And honestly, I totally didn't see myself as a lawyer, but I've always admired my dad, and I've always tried to please him and always tried to get his approval. So when he asked me if I could help him take this matter to court, what do you think I told him? Yeah, there were only three problems with that. I had no idea what copyright law was. I had no idea what to do in a courtroom. And the worst thing, there was no Google to help me figure this out. Long story short, after taking this very first case from the bottom court all the way up to one instance short of Supreme Court of Russia, I won this case for him. At the pinnacle of my Russian career, while I was with Baker McKenzie, I became the go-to lawyer for many multi-billion dollar companies for everything that had to do with copyright and domain names in Russia. To drop a couple of names, I've done work for Apple, Microsoft, DreamWorks, J.K. Rowling, Ford, and many, 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 many others. However, one very important thing was missing, and that is freedom. Throughout its long history, Russia never had that which separates a truly free country from a country of slaves and masters, and that is the respect for individual rights. Curiously, today's Russia, in many aspects, is closer to a free market economy than Canada or the US. But that is only until the government chooses to take it all away from you, and then you're done. Since my very first visit to the US when I was 13, I've wanted to live in the West. And 8.5 years ago, I gathered my courage and decided to live my dream and start everything from scratch and move to Canada. So my legal career in Canada evolved from having to go back to school, to law school for the full 3 years, getting licensed as a Canadian lawyer, failing to find employment as a lawyer, and starting my own firm. As I was building it, I came up with the idea of Trademark Factory, basically the idea that is today revolutionizing the trademarking industry. Today I run the only firm in the world that provides trademarking services with a free comprehensive trademark search for a single all-inclusive flat fee with 100% money-back guarantee. So lawyers would appreciate the 100% money-back guarantee on a service that doesn't fully depend on us. As I was building my business, I realized that I was still not enjoying the freedom. I was still missing it. The freedom to help my clients the way they want to be helped, not the way some law society bureaucrat deems it proper for my clients to receive trademarking services. So last year, I chose to voluntarily give up something that I spent years trying to get, my lawyer license. And from an intellectual property lawyer who understands and values entrepreneurship, I became an entrepreneur with deep knowledge of intellectual property. This was a huge leap out of my comfort zone and a very rewarding transformation in my life. My passion for intellectual property was ignited by my father's struggle to protect his music from being stolen. My passion for freedom and individual rights comes from realization that power-hungry Western leaders, together with millions of useful idiots, for decades have been trying to recreate the socialist nightmare from which I thought I was fleeing. And it is these two passions that have formed my view on intellectual property that I'm about to share with you. But before we can have a discussion about whether or not we should have IP laws or patent laws, and if yes, how far these laws should go and what they should do, we need to go back to the basics and analyze the reasons for having laws that protect intellectual property in the first place. There are only two such reasons, and these reasons are mutually exclusive. The first reason is to allow people who have created something that had not existed before to treat the fruits of their talent, their passion, their work, their creativity, their vision, their risk-taking, and as their property, and not to have it stolen from them. Under this paradigm, whether such protection benefits so-called society as a whole is irrelevant. The protected rights are valuable per se. Same way we criminalize rape, not because absence of rapes benefits the society as a whole, but because rape violates the natural right to life, liberty, and security of the person. Granted, it does happen to benefit all normal men to know that their mothers, wives, and daughters are not going to be raped while they go for a walk in the park. But laws against rape would still be proper even if men didn't care about their mothers, wives, and daughters, or even if the majority of men actually prefer to rape women with impunity. Laws against rape protect life, liberty, and security of potential victims of rape. Same way, under this first paradigm, intellectual property laws protect the property of creators and those who invest in what creators create. The other collectivist view on IP is that intellectual property only exists insofar as those laws benefit the public. And under this latter paradigm, the so-called society apparently has a right to use whatever cultural legacy it gets in hands upon, unless the government says you should get a permission from the intellectual property owner for that. For collectivists, the only purpose of intellectual property laws is to provide the most benefit to the public by granting certain rights to creators and thereby supposedly encouraging creativity. Philosophically, this approach towards creators is no different from when a slave owner gives his slaves just enough food so that the slave continues to be useful to the master. Collectivists know that one cannot distribute that which had not been created. But their solution is to focus on distribution. They use those without whom there'd be nothing to distribute as molding claim to build their totalitarian utopia. It's not a coincidence that among the first decrees issued by Bolsheviks in Russia, right just when they were slaughtering the Tsar family, one abolished patents and copyrights, and another one criminalized failure to work in a matter that in the state's opinion was useful to the society. Vladimir Lenin personally wrote and called for randomly killing those who did not work. You think it's a coincidence? Even though Soviet communism is over, the legacy of communism is not. The evil principle behind communism, socialism, and other forms of collectivism is that interests of the so-called society take priority over interests of each particular individual. By definition, collectivism requires that there is someone, usually a small group, who defines what it is in the best interest of the so-called society, which leads to squashing everyone who is not contributing their fair share. This is how collectivism invariably ends up with concentration camps and millions of people slaughtered in the name of the common good. I was born and lived most of my life in the country that killed tens of millions of its own citizens under this evil slogan, from each according to his ability, to each according to his needs. Evil because forced redistribution of wealth always comes at the expense of enslaving both those who received unearned benefits and those who are expected to provide them. As Frederick Bastiat wrote, the government is the great fiction through which everybody endeavors to live at the expense of everyone else. Now back to the issue of intellectual property. Historically, these two paradigms, one protecting interests of creators, regardless of whether they benefit the public, and the one that protects only insofar as it benefits the public, they have often been intermixed with advocates of one approach masking their ideas behind those of their opponents. Instead of openly stating that the interests of the public should be utterly irrelevant, proponents of the natural property rights approach would convincingly demonstrate that providing the broadest scope of protection to creators ends up benefiting the public. And instead of openly stating that creators should only be allowed to exist if they, as Bernard Shaw eloquently put it, could justify their existence by pulling their weight in the social boat, proponents of the common good approach would misnomer the privileges dispensed by the state to creators as property or rights, knowing full well that nothing that requires somebody else's permission is a right or property. This duality has led to numerous compromises and the absurd idea that we call today the balance of interests. Ayn Rand called it a compromise between a property owner and a burglar. I call it a balance between the interest of rapists and their victims. Neither is possible. The idea that the ultimate goal of intellectual property laws is to strike the perfect balance between the interests of creators and the public is ludicrous. The idea that intellectual property laws are only needed as long as the public benefits from them is evil. In answering the question whether we need patents and intellectual property laws, I refuse to take into account whether such laws create any benefits for those who had not created or financed that what intellectual property laws are supposed to protect. I've heard it all before. A great many fascinating pieces of art have been created by slaves. Myriads of amazing inventions were created at a time when no patents existed. John Sebastian Bach wrote the best music known to the humankind without the benefit of having the right to control reproduction of his manuscripts. I get it. Soviet copyright system was reduced to recognizing the right of the author to receive fair remuneration for the first use of the work. The amount of such remuneration was, of course, determined by the state. And then the author retained no rights to control the use of the work. Yet, Soviet authors, and my father among them, continued to create brilliant works of art. And many of them felt quite good about being on the dole of the government. At least the slaves who built the pyramids, is it pyramids or pyramids? Pyramids, thank you. They knew that there were slaves. At least the architects of Russia's most famous cathedral knew that there were slaves when Russian Tsar Ivan the Terrible ordered to gouge out their eyes and cut off their tongues in order to make sure that they wouldn't replicate the beauty of his cathedral. Many didn't realize that they were slaves. And as Goethe wrote, none are more hopelessly enslaved than those who falsely believe that they are free. Again, it's not about whether authors and inventors would continue to create. They would. It's about whether we look at them as individuals or as resources. Whether we recognize that they are free or if we treat them as slaves. Yes, if we further limited the degree of control that authors and inventors can exercise over their works and inventions, it is unlikely that we would face a rebellion of people who would suddenly refuse to create. They create because they can, because they're good at it, because they love it. This is the internal struggle that was so brilliantly demonstrated in Atlas Shrugged. But for us to abuse creators' love for what they do is immoral, even if we can easily get away with that. And don't tell me about the promoting the progress of science and useful arts language used in the US Constitution and the origins of Statute of Anne, which for the first time established copyright for the book publishers. We're not debating what the law was. We're not debating what the law is. We're debating what the law should be. And just because we have a set of laws as it is today, doesn't mean that it should not evolve. Only my opponents would like to castrate intellectual property. Well, I would want to see it get stronger. Another argument I hear all the time is that people get away with patenting obvious things. Yes, they do. And yes, it's a bad thing. But the solution is to improve methodology for examining and disputing patents. It shouldn't take 4 to 5 years and cost hundreds of thousands of dollars for a business to get a patent. Not all patents should last for 20 years. We live in the information age, yet we're still using 19th century technology that relies on a patent examiner's ability to properly identify all prior art in order to figure out if an invention is patentable. But what really infuriates me is the argument that intellectual property laws limit the rights of consumers to use their property.
such as computers. The argument goes like this. Someone has bought a computer, and if not for the artificial limitations imposed by the government in the form of intellectual property laws, they would be able to install whatever software, listen to whatever music, watch whatever movies on their computers without having to pay anyone. They see intellectual property as unlawful intervention by the government in the economy. That seems to be the only intervention by the government in the economy that they seem to be against. And the first time I heard this argument here in Canada, I thought to myself, они что, совсем охуели? Which, if translated into English, would sound something like, are you out of your minds? First of all, regardless of what the Supreme Court of Canada found in several of its latest judgments on copyright, despite what anyone else would have you believe, there is no such thing as the right of the public to use other people's works. There is no such thing as a right to a song that you didn't create. Just because you bought a car doesn't mean that you're entitled to free gas. Just because you bought a spoon doesn't mean you're entitled to a free quinoa salad. Just because you were born in the form of a human being doesn't entitle you to use somebody else's music. When you're told that you can't get free gas, food, or music, your rights are not being violated. And I would like to conclude with this. Just look around you. Everything that surrounds us is a result of someone's creative mind. The clothes you wear, this building, the plane that took me from Vancouver to Toronto, the car that got me from the airport to the hotel, this microphone, the internet, the computer, the software, this, everything, the cereal you've had for breakfast, espresso machines, I can go on and on and on and on. All of this would not have existed if it hadn't been created by someone. And I don't mean manual labor. I mean created in someone's brilliant mind. Even if that brilliant mind was standing on the shoulder of somebody else. Imagine your life without all of this. You may be the biggest fan of the Green Party and the biggest supporter of the environment. I'll tell you one thing. Living in a cave sucks. We must be forever grateful to all the people who have contributed to making our lives better and continue to contribute to make our lives better. And the least we can do for them is not to assume that they are our slaves and that their only purpose of their lives is to make our lives better. The least we can do for them is to say thank you to them, is not to steal from them. And our intellectual property laws are a way of expressing our gratitude, not by creating artificial new rights, but by recognizing the rights that are inherently owned by those who create that which had not existed before. It's the only moral way. Thank you.
Well, good morning, my name is Pierre Desrochers. Okay, that was impressive, Andrei. So I should point out at the beginning, Okay, so that works. Who am I and why am I here? Good question. So you can see, you could see on the first slide that I'm actually a geography professor. So as I make it clear here on my first slide, I have no legal training whatsoever. Of course, I could come up with some lousy reasons as to why to do so. Like, for example, I like facts and logical thoughts, but that's probably not something I should say. But to be fair, I could tell you the two standard jokes about geographers. So yes, I'm not looking for new continents for a living. And yes, we make the best cab drivers once we get our PhDs or Uber drivers. But what I'm interested in is the human creative process. And through research I did a couple of decades ago, I came to develop an interest in the patent system. I don't really have a strong opinion on copyrights and trademarks, but I'm strongly against patents, not only for patent trolls' reason, but because I fundamentally believe that they're incompatible with the human creative process, and they create a lot more problems than they deliver incentives. So I'll go quickly here. What does a geographer have to do with creativity? Well, one thing that economic geographers do, because I'm an economic geographer by training, is that we look at where wealth is created, how wealth is distributed the world over. So what you have here is a map that was produced by the team of my colleague, Richard Florida. So I don't know if you can see that in the back, but basically what you have is wealth, GDP per capita per geographical unit. So those big spikes that you see there are the world's largest city, because this is where wealth is both concentrated and created. Now, why do cities exist in the first place? Why did Andrei fly from Vancouver to Toronto rather than, I don't know, Timmins to Kingston or what have you? Well, there are a number of reasons for that. I mean, in short, cities make people more productive. Having creative people next to other creative people create positive externalities, so we're all more productive as a result. The branch of economic geography that I was interested in was the knowledge spillover and creation mechanism that occur when smart people live close to each other. So the standard example for that would be Silicon Valley, south of San Francisco. So I assume that this is a rather sophisticated audience. You're familiar with this, but why is it that in the internet age or in this communication age that we live in, smart people still feel the need to be so close to each other? Well, again, that's because being close to creative people gives you the opportunity to interact face to face with them. And despite Skype, despite all the new technologies we have, there's still no substitute to be close to other smart people. Now, Silicon Valley is the best known example, but if you look at history, you've got similar clusters in all sorts of industries the world over. So this was a map. This is a map to your left that was produced about a quarter of a century ago that described food cluster, packaging machineries, ski boot clusters all over Italy. Or Manhattan. I mean, Manhattan has changed a lot over the years, but you still have areas called the Financial District, the Garment District, the Fur District, the Diamond Districts. And that's because people of similar trade gathered to each other. Now, this is the kind of stuff that you typically learn about in a second year economic geography course. But you might remember Michael Porter from a few years ago, Harvard University professor, made tens of millions of dollars marketing second year economic geography to governments the world over. I just wanted to take a shot at him because we all hate him. So speaking of intellectual property and trademark, yeah, this is something I want. He came up with this model, which is basically what I teach for very little money to my second year students. Okay, so that's on the record. But what I did, though, was built on the word of on the work of a local celebrity, Jane Jacobs, who passed away a decade ago. And Jacobs argued, okay, Silicon Valley, the ski boot cluster in northern Italy, these are all interesting, but really, if you look at human creativity, you're missing the most important aspect of the picture, which is that the human brain essentially creates new things by combining existing things in new ways. Again, I don't know, I apologize if you cannot see that in the back, but you've got two trees here. These were produced by the American anthropologist Alfred Kroeber in 1948. So what you have on the left is what most of us think of as evolution, and the way I would argue many people think about intellectual creativity. You know, people create new things that have nothing to do with anything else. So a new species emerge, eventually the animals cannot reproduce with the species they originated from. That's how you form a new species. But cultural evolution, by contrast, is the tree to the right where branches intersect all the time. We create new ideas by combining and recombining and recombining relentlessly existing things in new ways. We all build on what came before us, and we make small incremental innovations by combining things in a new way. So just for the record, some economists a couple of decades ago tested Porter and Jacobs came out on top. Jacobs never charged anything really for speaking. Actually, she didn't want to speak to university and academics and politicians, and she turned out to be right compared to Porter's, but that's another debate. So, the standard arguments for and against patents. Again, this is a sophisticated audience. I assume you're familiar with that. So yes, patents can give you monopoly power, but they provide incentives that people would not have otherwise. Yes, there might be patent troll, but they make knowledge public. And if patents cover successful process innovation, they still end up benefiting consumers. So I could spend more time on that, but that's not the case I want to make here. Standard case against patent. Well, you know, a patent might become a monopolist. You might have a patent troll. A patent in practice is a right to exclude, but it only gives you the protection that money can afford. And so if you don't have hundreds of thousands of dollars to patent your stuff and defend yourself in court, a patent is useless, and a patent does not have any, it does not add any value to a bad idea. So, empirical research. Yeah, I know you're lawyers, you don't like that, but let me throw a few facts at you. Most patents have no economic value. Everybody acknowledges that. Whether it's 90% of patents or 99.5% of patents is not the argument I'm making here. The vast majority have no value whatsoever. Most important innovations are not patented. So people who have looked at, let's say, innovation prices that are run by a number of organizations find out that only about 10% of innovations that actually win prizes end up being patented. There's no really good research on that recently, but in the past and all the way up to the 1970s, it's believed that copying costs are actually much higher than most people believe. So the standard numbers, even though they're dated at this point, copying reasonably sophisticated innovation involves roughly about 65% as much money as 70% as much time. So, you know, it's not because you have a patent available to you that you can actually copy the thing, and it's not because you can buy a product that you can manufacture it successfully. There's a lot of learning that you're not aware of that you need to do in order to be able to copy someone. And historically, outside of chemistry and the pharmaceutical industry, where molecules can be precisely defined, nobody really cares about patents because you've got better ways to protect your property, be it trade secret, know-how that you do not divulge, being the first to market, constant technological innovations, especially in this age, licensing, but also complementary marketing, servicing capability, you know, your brand name, servicing your customers, always coming up with new products, being better than the competition in that respect, typically matter a lot more than having patents or not. Okay, so these are the sort of standard arguments. Let me try to be a little bit more original here and give you a little primer on intellectual creativity. So how do people come up with new ideas? Well, typically people who come up with new ideas, especially in the commercial realm, are people who are faced with practical problems. They try to solve them typically by first building on what they already know, but typically this isn't sufficient. So most inventors will try to learn about other stuff, and eventually, often through analogical reasoning, you know, observing something that works in another context and extracting the principle, seeing that you could incorporate it in whatever it is that you're doing to solve your problem, you sort of bring things, and this is how, through a period of trial and error, new successful combination eventually occur. But because there's no such thing as a perfect product, then of course you're dealing still with problems, and the goal is to create always lesser problems over time. But this is why ideas are constantly created. This is why economies constantly develop. There's no such thing as a perfect product. You keep finding problems, and you always try to solve it by combining and recombining things in new ways. So you can go back to the days of the caveman, actually. So you can see here a tool that was created by combining a stone scraper and a stone borer. So you wanted to remove the fat, you wanted to pierce a hole. Well, of course, why do you need two tools for that when you can create one? We have evidence that our remote ancestors were doing that. What you have to the left is a mine cart, you know, send that down in a coal mine. You have a steam engine that was used to pump the water out of the mine. You combine the two, and through much trial and error, you eventually get a locomotive and a railroad. Okay, I'm taking shortcuts here, but you get the idea. There's this notion, so, you know, finding a new use, a zipper. Nobody sort of remember what it was invented for, but of course you can apply a zipper to all sorts of things. Thomas Edison invented the phonograph, but never thought that it would be used to record music. At first he thought people would want to record the last words of dying people. Recording books for the blind, announcing clock time, teaching spelling, but recording music, why? Why? Who would want to do that, right? The steam engine, again, used first to pump water out of mines, but quickly adapted to cotton mills, locomotive, boats, and then think of the diesel engine, electric motors, lasers, what have you. I mean, countless applications can be found for whatever exists. Of course, commercial success is another issue, but... Okay, another example here, Henry Ford in the early 20th century has a wonderful problem. He cannot meet the demand for his new Ford Model T, so he gathers his engineers and said, guys, we've got to speed up production, what could we do? And it so happens that two of his engineers end up visiting a meatpacking plant, and they see a disassembly line. They say, uh-oh, why don't we just invert the process? Whoops, sorry. So instead of bringing in an animal and cutting it apart, why don't we just invert the process and put a car together? Now, of course, what they did then was to incorporate other ideas that they had observed in canning factories, flour milling, brewing industry, and a number of others. But the point here is that what looks radical in the car industry is something of an incremental improvement in another line of work. There are no such things as really disruptive innovations that completely take the world by storm. You have incremental innovations in one line of work that might seem radical in another, but a human brain does not create magical, wonderful new things out of nothings. We typically add little things to what already exists. So, in that context, what's the problem with patents? Well, the problem with patents is that they typically view both inventors and innovations as discrete, they view inventions as discrete events, discrete creations, standalone things. But the reality is that none of us, even if we create Atlas Shrugged or a great novel, really create it out of nothing. We build on things that we borrow from other people, and overall, our contribution is typically rather small. And the result is that in reality, again, all innovations are really incremental. They only look radical in the eyes of someone who doesn't know the industry or the original source of the idea. And every patent infringes on some other patent. And that's why in the real world, people typically cross-license patents. And this is why patents are really a form of protection money, because you cannot create something without infringing on some other patents. So another way to look at this is the prevalence of simultaneous inventions in history. Even if you look at things that are typically thought to be radical, calculus, well, if Newton had not come up with it, Leibniz was just a few months after him. The telephone, Elisha Gray and Alexander Graham Bell both filed for their patents the same day. Thermometer is thought to have 6 inventors, the apodator McNeil 3 inventors, vaccination 4, electric telegraph 5, photography 4, steamboat 5, electric railroad 6. Again, the point is that everybody is facing the same problem, and because you create new ideas by combining existing things in new ways, you all eventually, all creative people, live in a particular environment and are likely to borrow ideas from the same source, which is why you will always have simultaneous inventions. So, some of you might be familiar with the incandescent light bulb. Okay, it's illegal today for all sorts of bad reasons, I guess. But if you know the history a little bit, you might think, oh, Thomas Edison came up with it. If you're a good Canadian, you might have learned, well, there was this British guy, Joseph Swan, who came up with a similar idea at about the same time, and so they ended up cross-licensing their invention. What most people don't know is that there actually had been 22 versions of the light bulb before Edison came along. Of course, he made it better, but the point is that he did not create it out of nothing. He added better components to what already existed, but he was part of a larger intellectual milieu, if you will, where a lot of creative people were struggling with the same problem and building on existing things around them. So in short, to get back to Kroeber, the guy who came up with those trees at the beginning, the history of inventions is one endless chain of parallel instances. Inventions will come along, people will create stuff, because most people only add little things. And in the end, competition will make them do it. If you're in business, you know, in the great race of life, you cannot stand still. You will have no choice but to invent, and because you will make incremental innovations by building on ideas and things that already exist around you, you will move ahead and come up with a better mousetrap. So my conclusion, yeah, real property rights indeed do matter for economic prosperity, but the idea of intellectual or technology property rights are not. They're completely at odds with the way the human brain works, and patents should be abolished. Thank you.
So as someone who has dealt with, I've actually testified on behalf of the patent attorneys at one point. So drug companies, typically to make a drug to go from bench to market costs around $1 billion. Without some years of patent protection, doesn't that make it not worthwhile for them to do?
No, I agree with you. And that's why I singled out the chemistry and pharmaceutical products at the beginning. They're the industries in which patents are viewed as valuable, unlike all the others. Is this working? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But then, I don't know if I should say that. A few years ago, I visited the headquarters of Eli Lilly in Indiana. And I said, okay, guys, off the record, if it wasn't for the FDA and all that you have to go through, would you really care about patents? They said, maybe not so much. So I think the issue in that case is both that the molecule can be clearly defined and the governmental regulatory process that mandates all these tests and imposes all these costs. So I don't have an easy solution for pharmaceuticals. I know that patents are valuable in the present context, which is why I mentioned this issue. But it's a tough one. I think we should scrap them for everything else. Chemistry and pharmaceuticals, I'm still struggling with that.
Should I answer that as well?
Yeah, go ahead. Yep.
So what I would answer with is actually bring you back to Pierre's first slide where he showed the map of all those developed countries. You would see it's not a coincidence that all those spikes are with the countries that have very developed intellectual property laws. And how much innovation really do we get from countries that don't have that protection? We don't. So to me, yes, pharmaceuticals is important, but it's not the only area where patents are important.
Yeah, my question is for Andrei. I formulated this when you were speaking as a hypothetical, but then Pierre actually gave a specific example of it. So my concern about patents, because they are monopolies essentially, created and enforced by the state. Suppose you get an inventor of something in British Columbia and an inventor of something in Newfoundland, and they both file their patent applications on the same day. And Pierre said, that was exactly what happened with Alicia Gray, whom I've never heard of before, and Alexander Graham Bell. Why should one person, the guy whose patent, whose application happens to be opened by the patent examiner before the other guy, why should that person get granted the patent and the other person who has invented something similar that would violate the first patent, why should that person not have the same rights as the person who just happened to be opened first? Because it seems like a coincidence rather than any merit. They've both essentially invented the same thing. They both should have property in it.
And that's precisely why we have completely different approaches for protecting copyright and patents, because we recognize that the chances of somebody writing the same book as you will write the same words are nil, whereas the chances of somebody inventing the same thing are substantial. So that's why, while we provide copyright protection for the entire life plus 50 or 70 years, depending on where you live, with patents, they decided to have a really short term of protection so that basically, yes, it does become the case of who runs to the patent office first. So they recognize that there was some artificial contract around this, but they say we'll compensate for it by not extending that protection forever, right? That's one thing. And the other thing, just going back to your idea about monopoly and monopoly being a bad thing, every right, every true right is a monopoly. My right to life is my monopoly, right? I am the only person who has the monopoly to decide how I should live my life. So same thing with property. I don't really see a problem with monopoly as long as it's not a monopoly that's artificially created by the government, and I don't believe that intellectual property is such a monopoly.
So my question, I think, primarily is for Andrei, but I'd be interested to hear what Pierre thinks. I agree with you that the collectivist interest should not be the one that prevails in deciding what property rights exist. But my understanding of patents in particular is that that is the rationale for their existence. So in accordance with what Pierre suggested, there seems to be a conceptual distinction between our traditional property rights, rights to person, rights to things, rights to land, and those other intellectual property rights like patents that are created for the purpose of furthering the collective interest by creating incentives to create. So I agree with you about the rejection of that rationale, but if we reject that rationale, how do you use the personal interest to decide where the lines are drawn? How do you decide when a patent is justified? Why wouldn't we simply say, well, whatever you discover, whatever you create, automatically creates an intellectual property right? If we did that, then wouldn't we be in a situation where everybody was prevented from using everything because there's a patent on everything that exists? So for example, if you go into the woods and discover a rock, a big, huge boulder that no one else has seen before, and you put it on a map, isn't that now your property? Because you have discovered it, and nobody else saw it before, you had an incentive to discover it, and therefore nobody else is allowed now to put it on a map. Doesn't this sort of stretch the bounds of credulity? Does this make sense?
It does. Thank you for the question. Patents don't protect discoveries.
But distinguish discoveries from inventions. My point is this, that the state is in the position of defining when an invention exists and when the thing is just a discovery. And do you really want the state to be in the position of deciding what the distinction between those two things is?
I want the mechanism for figuring out what's patentable and what is not patentable to be a lot better than it is today. I agree with those who say that currently, as it stands today, it makes no sense. I agree that the system as it is today is broken. But my approach to the issue is to fix the problem, not to kill whatever is left of it. So I agree with you that it shouldn't take this long for somebody to figure it out, because actually in my book, The Ultimate Insider's Guide to Intellectual Property, I wrote that here's how you decide whether or not you want to patent or not patent whatever you came up with. So I say, if there's any other way for you to protect what you came up with other than patenting, don't patent it, right? So I'm not blindly saying that, you know what, patents is amazing, and without patents, we'd all die. No. But what I am saying is that the system should be improved in a way that it wouldn't take you this long, and it would have it wouldn't take you this much money to go through this, because most people can't afford it, and especially the smaller guys. And intellectual property laws initially, they were invented to protect the little guy, not the big guys. Right, because the big guys have all the advertising money, they have all the litigation money that they can throw at anybody else. So they are the ones who need IP the least. Really the trend that is now impossible to protect your patent unless you have millions of dollars is relatively novel. In fairness, the other thing I wanted to mention is that especially in the US, there's an industry of what's called intellectual property insurance, right? So if you get a patent, or if you're just in a business that deals with something innovative, they don't get just the regular errors and omissions insurance. They buy their IP insurance, which works two ways. First of all, it allows you to enforce your own patents against other people. And second, it allows you to protect yourself against those claims. But just to go back to your idea, we do need a structure that would make it clearer and easier for people to figure out what they can and what they cannot do, and for people to figure out what they can and cannot protect. The reason I say don't go with patents if you can't do something other than that is because most businesses can't afford to be in a situation when they sit on an idea for 5 or 6 years before they know whether they can monetize on it. It's crazy, I agree with you. I believe that there are ways to figure out the what and the how, but the first thing we need to do is to give an answer as to why. Because if we're talking about why we're doing it in terms of, is this really resulting in more inventions for the good of the public, then we have to look at the system completely different from the idea of how do we make sure that we come up with a fair resolution between competing claims of five inventors who came up with the same thing, right? Who are we protecting? What is the ultimate goal? Once we give the answer to that question, then we can start looking at to what's and how's. But before we agree on that, it's just a discussion that makes absolutely no sense, because my what's and how's would be completely different from Pierre's. And somebody who tries to balance them out would come up with something we have today that makes no sense for anybody. Does that answer your question?
In good measure, thank you.
Thank you.
Does Pierre have any thoughts?
Well, I don't know. We spent a lot of time. All I'll say is that a rock would not be patented, but there were a lot of debates when Diamond V. Chakrabarty came along a number of decades ago when patenting life forms. But no, I don't want to get into that. I would rather have other questions.
Hi, my question is also for Andre, because I largely agree with Pierre. But I'm curious, the way you framed the sort of way to address IP in your talk seemed to be very much of natural rights.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the way I understand it right now, patents and copyright are sort of are built around a utilitarian desire to give people access to things that are created while also rewarding the creators. So if we take a natural rights sort of approach to this and say you have an inherent right to profit from your property, to restrict it for other people not to use it, should patents, copyrights ever expire, or should we just not be able to print Shakespeare because we can't get permission from the author to reprint it?
So for copyrights, currently it's life plus 50 or 70 years. And I think that this system also should be changed because the vast majority of the works of copyright, their authors and copyright owners have no interest of maintaining it for this long. So I actually do believe that for copyrights, there should be a positive action on behalf of the authors and property owners to actually demonstrate to the world that they're still interested in protecting it. For patents, basically I already said this, because the original premise that the same idea that can be patented can go, that come to several people's heads at almost the same time, and it really becomes a measure of luck in many cases who runs to the patent office first. I believe that, you know, philosophically I'm okay with figuring out some arbitrary number when that protection is gonna lapse. I think really for different types of inventions it has come the time to have separate terms. Like for example, the duration of protection for software should not be the same as duration of protection for pharmaceuticals. It makes no sense. With your software, you don't have an interest of maintaining the same patent for 20 years. That's why most people don't do it. So if it was up to me, I would probably look into creating some sort of mini patents for things that are relatively small but still need to be protected, to things that are kind of medium, and to things that are, you know, huge inventions. So for them, we can consider even making that period longer. I don't know, right? And just to be fair, I have not filed one single patent application in my life. I'm not a patent lawyer, right? But I understand how the patent, how the system works. So, but I'm okay with some arbitrarity there, simply because there is some arbitrarity in how you get them protected in the first place.
Thank you both for covering, I think, what I think are the range of arguments put forward for intellectual property for and against. But there was one particular argument that I thought was missing, and it's actually the one I find most compelling. I'd be curious to hear your thoughts on that argument. And that argument is simply that there's a categorical qualitative difference between intellectual property and all other forms of property, and that relates to whether or not that property, some people use the word scarce, can someone else use that while you're also using that. So for a simple example might be, if I have an apple, that particular apple cannot be eaten by any two people at the same time, right? Like if I'm eating that apple, you can't also do that. Whereas an idea, like I can have an idea in my head, at least in theory, some people will say that no two ideas are the same, but you can have an idea in your head about the apple or about how to use that apple in your new invention, and someone else can simultaneously have that same idea. And in that sense, there's a principled way of distinguishing them that to me seems very relevant when we're talking about assigning property rights and control over the distribution of these resources in this institution. I was just wondering what you both thought about that.
Well, that was kind of implicit in my presentation, and I sort of alluded to that in the last slide. Yeah, no, I agree with you. It's, that's a very compelling argument, but I tried to take it to another level and illustrate how new ideas come along and why they cannot be excluded. But this being said, the argument that because an idea is out there, everyone can use it is completely wrong. I mean, there are plenty of stuff available on, I don't know, theoretical physics, yeah, but I won't be able to make any sense of it, you know, without investing for several years. And the same is true with all ideas. I mean, there is a steep learning curve in terms of learning, you know, about manufacturing technologies or ideas and stuff, and that's the real cost of doing business. The cost of copying is much more significant than people think. So while ideas cannot be in theory excluded, or while they're commonly held, the investment you need to make to be able to use them is often much more significant than most people believe.
So to me, scarcity really is not about whether it's tangible or not, because the value of a CD-ROM is negligible compared to all the good stuff that you can record onto it. Like the entire library of, you know, Shakespeare and many, many other authors will fit in the same CD-ROM. It's to say that the value of the actual physical object is greater than the value of the content, I don't want to even try to find the adjective for that, but really, when what's protected by IP is not the idea, right? It's the right to control, which is as scarce as any physical device, right? So for the authors and inventors, the way they look at their stuff is when somebody takes their idea, is not that they're stealing the idea itself. It's that they're stealing their right to say yes or no, it's mine. And just to get back to my personal story, my dad, to him, it really mostly was about whether somebody asked him or not. So we had completely different licensing prices for people who asked permission in advance compared to people who asked permission the day before the song was supposed to be aired on TV, and compared to those who asked permission after it was aired on TV but before we caught them, and last one was after we caught them without them asking us, right? It's the same thing that was used, but to him it was a matter of respect. And it's completely different. You know, people who create, they are they're very fragile, right? And they kind of expect that when they come up with something brilliant that people want to use. Because really, and as Pierre is correct in that a lot of stuff that's being created is junk that nobody wants. But the only way to find out what it is, you know, to get it out there. I would argue that most people who are being born also don't provide a ton of value to the rest of humanity, but it does mean that we should just kill them all.
Yeah, a question for Pierre. I'm still digesting that remark.
So am I.
Yeah, a question for Pierre. So I'm the co-author of a textbook in political sciences, just been in print for over 30 years, now tragically about to go out of print. We followed your strategy of constantly updating, as you were talking about, and it went through 9 editions. But, you know, this was all a lot of work, writing it and updating it. And I'm sure that I wouldn't have done it if it hadn't been for royalties, which in turn, the publisher wouldn't have granted royalties if they couldn't have enforced a copyright.
Yes.
So does your argument about patent also extend into the area of copyright?
Well, that's what I mentioned at the beginning. I have strong opinions about patents, copyrights. I don't know. I mean, I published a book. Of course, it was not as successful as your textbook. You know, I sold a few thousand copies and that was it. But what I've been doing over the years, and a lot of my colleagues, well, I don't know if they hate me for that, but there's now plenty of freely available material on what I teach, and I teach mostly, you know, energy policy, international trade, food, and so I've tried to minimize my use of textbooks for years, and students really like me for that, because then they don't have to spend like $100 for a textbook who's modified just enough so that they won't be able to use the previous edition, because, you know, the new edition will be just different enough to make sure that they have to spend the money. And I make all my syllabus available to the world. I've put a lot of effort in developing my classes. I try to publish as much as I can in open access journal. I'm very naive that way, but you know, I'm paid by taxpayers, and I figured that the least I can do is make my stuff available to the world. But this being said, I recognize the effort you put into it, especially in the era before Google, so you know, I understand that when you published your textbook, it was worth a lot. So I'm still of two minds on copyrights, but my own personal stance is that I try to minimize the use of textbooks, so don't take me for that, Tom, but that's...
Gentlemen, thank you so much for the presentation. Professor Desrochers, I heard you at Rothbard University, and I'm looking forward to your presentation on the 19th at Mises. I guess I have a question.
Sorry, can I plug that? That will be about Jane Jacobs, nothing to do with patents.
Nothing to do with patents, and the last talk at Rothbard U was on food production. This is fantastic. I have a question, a couple of quick comments. My question is, because you didn't mention it, and this is what patent law has become today, what do you think of the secondary and tertiary market in patents, which frankly, and you know, to be blunt, in my opinion, has become a goddamned abomination and has completely squelched innovation, where you have a specter of mutually assured destruction by legal proceedings by companies who are worth billions of dollars. Anyone else who tries to compete can be easily blown out of the water. So the original patent system, which was designed to protect individuals, is now doing exactly the opposite. What's your take?
Okay, well, my take is that patents today are essentially protection money. You want to acquire some in order to be able to negotiate a deal against somebody who's much bigger than you. It's the right, it's what you need to pay to have the right to play the game. I'm with you on that. But then I would also debate the idea that patents were ever devised to protect the small guy against the large firms. I might be naive about that, but you know, they came from government monopoly. They reinvented the logic behind the lettre patente, which was governments actually granting monopoly to some producers. And because the rationale behind patents has always been at odds with the way human creativity works, I would argue that from the beginning, they were always more useful to big players than to small inventors. And having worked with Inventors Association for my doctoral research, you know, the thing that inventors realize after they've spent money, and we're talking mostly the late 1990s, it was not as costly as today, they realize that, well, the only people who think that patents are important are people who don't understand how the system works, at least from the perspective of a small guy. The perspective of a large firm, I'm with you, it's protection money, it's a way to keep competitors at bay. So that's where I'm from. I'm for scrapping the system, save perhaps pharmaceutical and chemical issues for which I don't know how to deal with the real-world conditions we have at the moment.
Do you have any comment?
Yeah, well, just because an inventor does not have the funds to implement the invention doesn't make what he creates less valuable, right? And just because it will be the big guys or the big players who are going to buy his invention from him doesn't make the system wrong. It makes the system right, because that's the only way the big guys would even buy something from him, because if they didn't have to buy, they'd just take it, right? So his ability to, in the US, get a provisional patent, which actually is a very good idea, get some protection and then try to, you know, pitch it to the big guys, that's how the whole thing works, because corporations don't invent anything. Corporations are people. Right, and there has to be somebody's brilliant mind who comes up with an innovation, however big or incremental that innovation is. Right, there's nothing wrong with that the innovation is incremental. This is how we grow. And if the increment is worth somebody investing into building that increment up, then it's a good increment and it's worthy of protection.
Okay, quickly, that's from the perspective of a small inventor, nobody will be interested in buying your invention if you have not proved its market value to begin with. And often when large corporations meet small inventors or individual inventors, they insist that they have at least a provisional patent so that they can later claim that whatever that guy brought to me is not what we did. You know, we were working on parallel lines and he came with something. And so that this is a way to protect them against that. And the idea that large corporations would steal from inventors, that would be terrible PR. I mean, from what I was told by people on the corporate side of things, the last thing you want to do is this image of you, the big guy, stealing from the small inventor. So the cost in terms of negative PR are also significant. Now, I'm not saying that sometimes bad things will not happen, but overall, I think the combination of these factors makes it unlikely that patents are really crucial for the small guy to really sell their ideas to large corporations. Nobody wants to buy an unproven idea, as there are too many bad patents. A patent's are nothing to the value of a bad idea. You need to prove that your idea has already some market potential, some market sales, before anyone will be interested in stealing it. So, and once you get there, then the corporations will typically buy you out rather than, but anyway, that's...
Have you seen the movie Flash of Genius?
No, I haven't.
It's a great movie about the guy who invented the intermittent, wipers?
Windshield wipers.
Yeah, so he didn't invent the wipers. He invented the mechanism that turned them on when the rain was starting to fall. So that was just as you
so
say.
So is it more accurate than The Big Short, you know, where, you know, the
it's actually almost pure fiction, that movie, unfortunately. Not The Big Short, but Flash of Genius.
Well, The Big Short is pure fiction, I think, but anyway.
Well, Flash of Genius is based on facts.
But the... There was the whole case in the movie was
it was
willful infringement. In reality, it was not willful infringement, and they changed a lot of the facts in the movie.
Well, they had to make a movie out of it.
Yeah,
but that shows how this works in terms of how an inventor sees this. Right, it was made from that perspective.
Yeah, and just a comment. You only have so much time to mention this sort of stuff, but I mean, it's worth mentioning that really no discussion on patents, especially in the 1800s and early 1900s, is complete without any kind of a discussion on Tesla versus Edison, how one became one of the richest people in the United States and the other one died penniless, and similar to Charles Goodyear, who failed to patent in the United States, filed patents in Britain, he also died penniless, and his name and corporation lived on from other people. So patents don't always protect you if you're not backed by capital. And I guess the third thing to mention is, you mentioned Alexander Graham Bell. He sold all of his shares in Bell Telephone in 1878 when he was screwed out of the company in terms of his being CEO, similar to what happened to Cisco Systems. So he really didn't take part in the capital appreciation of the company, which was to become one of the biggest companies in the world. Thank you so much, though, for your presentation. Greatly appreciated. Okay.